Good afternoon, and welcome to this virtual meeting of the Scottish Parliament. First item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so the Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I will give our latest assessment today of the spread of Omicron, and in light of that, I will confirm no immediate changes to the protections currently in force or to the advice that we are giving the public. However, I'll also talk about the data that we will be monitoring closely in the days ahead as we assess the likely impact of this wave of infection and the continued necessity and proportionality of our response. I'll also briefly summarise the protective measures which took effect earlier this week to help slow spread and provide some further detail of the support available to businesses. Finally, I'll report on the delivery of booster vaccinations. First though, today's statistics. 15,849 positive cases were reported yesterday, 28.9% of all tests carried out. Now, it's worth noting that the much higher test positivity experienced over recent days may be partially explained by people being more selective about when to go for a test over the Christmas period. However, this is by some margin the highest overall daily case number reported in the pandemic to date. 679 people are currently in hospital with COVID, which is 80 more than yesterday, and 36 people are in intensive care, one fewer than yesterday. I'll say more shortly about the numbers of people with COVID in hospital and why this is an important indicator as we judge the most proportionate response going forward. Sadly, though, a further 3 deaths have been reported, taking the total number of deaths under this daily definition to 9,836. And once again, I want to send my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one. Presiding Officer, it's clear from these figures that the wave of Omicron that has been predicted is now rapidly developing. Omicron now accounts for around 80% of all cases, and over the past week, the number of reported cases of COVID overall has increased by 47%. We should also bear in mind that any transmission over recent days will not yet be fully evident in the reported figures. So it is reasonable to assume that we will continue to see steep increases in cases in the days and indeed possibly in the weeks ahead. That said, it is also important to remember that our individual and collective behaviour will influence how fast or otherwise the virus spreads. The current surge would almost certainly be even higher, but for so many people following advice to cut down on social interactions in the run-up to Christmas. And given the speed and extent of the transmission we are experiencing now, it is really vital that we all continue to take sensible precautions and limit social interactions for a further period as we learn more about the likely impact of this wave of infection and as we complete the booster vaccination programme. Obviously, one of the factors we are looking at most closely is the proportion of Omicron cases that require hospital treatment. This will tell us more about the severity of Omicron for individuals and also about the overall impact that it's likely to have on the NHS. This will therefore inform our ongoing response. Before I say more about that, though, it is worth emphasising that there are other reasons to do all we can at this stage to slow down the spread. Firstly, whatever the overall impact of Omicron turns out to be, we know that this virus will cause serious illness and death for some. We also know that for others, long COVID will cause ongoing suffering. Secondly, we know that high levels of infection and therefore sickness absence will be disruptive to the economy and the delivery of critical services. And I'll say more later about how we are seeking to mitigate this. However, as things stand, none of us should be complacent about getting COVID. We should take steps to avoid it if we can. There is no doubt, however, that the data we are looking at most closely just now is the conversion of cases into hospital admissions. And there are here some grounds for optimism. Over the past week, published studies have suggested that the risk of hospitalisation from Omicron is lower possibly significantly lower than for other strains of the virus. What is not yet fully understood is why this might be the case, whether it is because Omicron is inherently less severe or because of its greater ability to infect those who've had prior infection or been vaccinated, which means that more of those who get it carry a level of immunity that protect them from more serious illness. We don't yet know the answer to that, but either way, if it is the case that a much lower proportion of people with Omicron need hospital care compared to other strains of the virus, that is really good news, especially as Omicron is now the dominant strain, and good news both in terms of individual health and overall impact. And of course, it would inform how we respond in the weeks ahead. However, and this remains key, for at least the next couple of weeks, we do need to show continued caution as we assess in real time the impact that these higher case numbers will have on the NHS. It is encouraging that, at least until now, the rise in cases experienced over the past few weeks has not translated into a corresponding rise in hospital admissions or occupancy. On the contrary, the number of people in hospital with COVID has so far remained broadly stable. However, again, we do need to exercise caution. The numbers in hospital with COVID in England is now rising quite sharply, which may be a sign of things to come here. And indeed, today's reported increase in hospital occupancy here of 80 is the biggest increase that we have seen for some time. We also know that there is a time lag between rising cases and rising hospital admissions. And of course, in terms of sheer numbers, the benefits of a lower rate of hospitalisation could be quickly cancelled out by the much higher case numbers resulting from significantly increased transmissibility. So we will monitor all of this data very carefully in the days to come. As well as looking at headline numbers, we will also be interrogating the detail, for example, the breakdown between those in hospital because of COVID and those in hospital who have COVID but who were admitted for different reasons. And we'll also be looking at whether the average length of stay in hospital for those with Omicron is different to other variants. All in all, I would expect that within the next couple of weeks, we will have a clearer picture and that this will then help us reach informed judgments about the most proportionate response going forward. In the meantime, however, while we better understand the impacts and while more and more of us get the added protection of booster vaccinations, which will, of course, help reduce the impacts of Omicron, we must try to avoid the sheer volume of cases overwhelming us. That is why it is prudent, indeed, I would say it is essential, that we do act to slow transmission at this stage as much as possible. Indeed, that is why additional protections were announced last week and are now in force, and I'll summarise these shortly. And it's also why over Hogmanay and New Year's Day, and for at least the first week of January, we are advising everyone to stay at home more than normal, to reduce contacts with people outside our own households, and to limit the size of any indoor social gatherings that do take place so that they don't include people from any more than three households. Also try to ventilate indoor spaces as much as possible. And it remains our advice, our strong advice, that lateral flow tests should be taken just before meeting up with anyone from another household. And if that shows a positive result, it is vital to immediately isolate and book a PCR test. You should also isolate and book a PCR test if you have symptoms that might be COVID. Following this advice is difficult and frustrating at the best of times, I know, but it is even harder at this time of year. But it really does help, and it will be helping already, notwithstanding these very high case numbers. So please do stick with it for now. In addition to this general advice to the public, the new protective measures relating to hospitality, public indoor places and live events that I set out last week are now in force. We will review these on an ongoing basis, but at this stage, our expectation is that they will be in force until the 17th of January. That means, for now, limits on the size of live public events, though private life events such as weddings are exempt. For indoor standing events, the limit is 100, for indoor seated events, 200, and for outdoor events, 500 seated or standing. I know some question the rationale for this, so let me set it out again. Firstly, the higher transmissibility of Omicron means that large gatherings have a much greater potential to become rapid super spreader events. Second, there are transmission risks associated with travel to and from such events. And thirdly, they do place significant demands on emergency services such as the police and the ambulance service. And at a time when emergency services are already dealing with high levels of staff absence due to the virus, not having large-scale public events allows these services to focus on the delivery of core services to the public. As well as limits on large events, further protections are now in force for hospitality and other indoor public places. A requirement for table service has been reintroduced for venues that serve alcohol for consumption on the premises, and guidance has been issued to the effect that indoor hospitality and leisure venues should ensure 1 metre distance between different groups of customers. The one group, whether it is made up of one, two or three households, should be physically distanced from other such groups in the same venue. Finally, unfortunately, nightclubs are now closed until 17th January, unless they have decided to remain open without dancing as hospitality premises, in which case they will be required to follow the same rules and guidance as other hospitality venues. All of these protections are important to help us deal with and reduce the impact of the public health challenge that COVID represents. However, they also have a very significant impact on businesses. 2 weeks ago, I announced £100 million to support businesses affected by the advice to minimise contacts over the festive period. We've already detailed the allocation of that. However, last week I announced a further £275 million of support, and I can give some further detail today of how the first £100 million of that additional support is being allocated. £16 million will be made available to support public transport providers through existing COVID support schemes. £27 million will go to the culture sector and a further £17 million to the events sector. A further £32 million will be allocated to hospitality and leisure businesses, with an additional £10 million for those parts of the hospitality industry most severely impacted by the requirement for table service. And up to £5 million will be allocated to nightclubs required to close. We're also working closely with the sports sector. Sporting events are obviously affected by the limit on spectators and also by cancellations due to COVID absences. However, we also know that some of this impact will be alleviated by the rescheduling of events, so we want to make sure that the support we provide is effectively targeted, and we will be confirming further details soon. In total, we have now reached decisions on the allocation of £207 million of the £375 million being made available for business support, and councils are now working to get that money into bank accounts as fast as possible. Decisions on the allocation of the remaining funds will be confirmed following consultation with affected sectors on how it can be best targeted. Presiding Officer, I know how difficult all of this is for business, and I really wish it wasn't necessary, and I hope it's not necessary for long. But there simply isn't an easy trade-off between protecting health and protecting the economy. If COVID continues to spread rapidly, the economic impact in the form of staff absences and diminished consumer confidence will be severe, and we're already seeing those impacts. So doing nothing won't help business. We must protect public health and the economy together by slowing the speed at which COVID is spreading while we complete the booster programme. Signing off, so there are two further issues I want to touch on this afternoon. I mentioned earlier the need to mitigate the impact of staff absences on the economy and critical services. Now, obviously, the best way of doing this is by stemming transmission, but we must also ensure that the requirements for isolation are proportionate. I indicated last week that we were weighing the risks and benefits of shortening the isolation period for index cases and also potentially easing the requirement for all household contacts to isolate following a positive case. These are finely balanced judgments, and we are considering the current trends in infection carefully. However, I can confirm that we do hope to reach decisions in the next week, with any changes taking effect from the 5th of January, and we will keep Parliament updated. In the meantime, we have introduced a sectoral exemption scheme subject to appropriate protections, and I can confirm today a further change that will help ensure that the exemption scheme, which is dependent on speedy turnaround of PCR tests, is effective. The current surge in cases does mean that testing capacity, sampling and processing capacity is under pressure. So we are now prioritising some slots for essential workers, such as NHS and transport staff, as well as for those who are clinically vulnerable or eligible for new COVID treatments. And this ensures that essential workers will get the test results they need to qualify for an exemption promptly. This is a sensible step to take at this stage. However, notwithstanding this priority for essential workers, let me stress that testing remains available for anyone who needs it. If you try to book a test and can't find a slot in a location you can get to, do try again later. Additional PCR slots are released throughout the day. Test and Protect is also for now focusing its telephone tracing on high-risk settings, such as care homes. The majority of us, if we test positive, will be contacted by text or email rather than by phone. So if you are contacted by Test and Protect, either as a positive case or a close contact, please do respond and complete the online form and make sure you follow all advice given. The final point the vital point, indeed, I want to update on today is the progress of the vaccination programme. Before I do so, though, let me address this point. I've heard people ask in recent days what the purpose of booster vaccination is if we still have to restrict our activities for a period. And I understand that question, but it is the answer that it is vital for all of us to understand. Firstly, getting a booster doesn't mean we won't get COVID, though it will reduce the chances of that. But what it does do is significantly enhance our protection against serious illness. Getting boosted could quite literally save your life. Because it doesn't completely stop us getting or passing on the virus, those not fully vaccinated are still at significant risk. We won't get the full benefit of the booster programme as a country until the maximum number of us are fully vaccinated, which does mean that anyone choosing not to be vaccinated without good reason is acting irresponsibly. But the key point is this: until the programme is completed, and we're getting closer to that every day, we still need to slow down the spread. In recent weeks, there has been a huge increase in booster appointments, and I want to put on record again my thanks to everyone involved in the delivery of the programme and to everyone coming forward to be boosted. 75% of those eligible for a booster or a third dose have now received one. That represents excellent progress, but to deliver maximum benefits, we need maximum numbers to get boosted as quickly as possible. We want to get to, or as close as possible to, the target of having 80% of eligible adults boosted by the bells. And getting there depends on both capacity and demand. Let me make very clear, we definitely have enough capacity now to meet that target. What we need between now and the end of the week is high demand, eligible people who aren't yet boosted to come forward now and get the jag. High numbers of positive cases are making things more difficult, because if you get the virus, you can't get the vaccine for a period afterwards. So cancellation and do not attend rates have been creeping up this week as case numbers have risen. But to everyone out there who isn't yet boosted but could be, please book an appointment now or go to a drop-in clinic. If you have an appointment booked for January, please reschedule it for this week. There are plenty of slots available. Please, please don't delay. Every single booster jag administered now is a step on the road back to normality. And remember, if you haven't had your first or second jag yet, it's never too late for that either. Please make sure you get those now. Presiding Officer, to draw my remarks to a conclusion, it's an understatement to say that the situation we face now is not what any of us want. And I have to be clear that the period immediately ahead will not be an easy one. That said, I do hope that the clearer picture we will have in the next couple of weeks will also prove to be a much more positive picture. And we can all help to make it so. So please do get fully vaccinated. Do it this week. The more of us who are boosted, the less severe the impact of Omicron will be, and the sooner we will all return to normality. Secondly, please test regularly. The advice if you're meeting other people is to test before you go every single time and take your test as close as possible to the time you will be seeing other people. This is really important if you are planning to meet people from other households over Hogmanay, although I would encourage you to please minimise that. And finally, take all of the other precautions which can help make a difference. Work from home whenever possible. Stay at home right now more than normal and reduce your contacts as much as possible, as I said, even over Hogmanay. If you do visit indoor public places, limit the number of households in your group to 3 at most. Wear a face covering on public transport, in shops and when moving around in hospitality, and make sure the covering covers fully your mouth and nose. Keep windows open if you're meeting indoors and follow all advice on hygiene. Sticking to this is really hard, but it does keep us safer and gives us the ability to slow down spread of the virus as we complete the all-important booster programme. Signing Officer, this has, and this is another understatement, been another really difficult year. But despite these renewed challenges that we face now, I do firmly believe, largely because of vaccination, that 2022 will be a better year. Let me conclude by thanking everyone again for all of the sacrifices made over this year and by wishing everyone a very happy new year when it comes. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 55 minutes for questions, and it would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question put R in the chat function now. And I call on Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by putting on record that I recognise the hardship faced by people across Scotland at this time. Because of the restrictions, we've seen scaled back or cancelled Christmas and New Year celebrations. But there is some good news. The booster programme continues to be rolled out, increasing our protection against the Omicron variant. Anyone who hasn't done so yet, go out and get their booster. Last week, I again asked the First Minister to make changes to self-isolation rules, to allow household contacts to end self-isolation if they have a negative PCR result, and to reduce the isolation period from 10 days to 7 if they test negative twice. However, the First Minister's message today on these essential changes is yet again to tune in next week. We've had the groundbreaking Omicron study that shows while it's more transmissible, it is less severe. So, First Minister, what more information do you need to take the steps on self-isolation that we've been calling for weeks?
First Minister.
Well, this is one of the most important and actually one of the most difficult decisions we will take in recent days. I know England has already reduced the self-isolation period for index cases. Wales hasn't done it. I don't believe Northern Ireland has done it yet either. And that, I think, illustrates the finely balanced nature of this judgment, and I'll say a bit more about that in a moment. But it is also really important that we understand the context for making that decision. Douglas Ross rightly points to the more positive news in the studies that were published just before Christmas, but as the authors of these studies themselves point out, it is important not to overinterpret these studies or get carried away by the initial data that they provide. While they do suggest that the hospitalisation rate associated with the Omicron is lower than for other variants, perhaps significantly lower, that will not give us any benefit if the overall volume of cases cancels that out and leads us to a higher number of people going into hospital overall. So that is why it is really important that we don't allow the infection numbers to overwhelm us, which brings me back to why the decision on isolation is important to get right, because if we release people from isolation while they may still be infectious, then yes, we will relieve some of the pressure that we're seeing on the economy, and that is not to be underestimated, but that will be short-lived, because the risk we take is that we will actually accelerate the spread of the virus, and then that pressure on the economy will increase in the medium to longer term. So we need to get this right. Why do I say that we are still taking a few more days? Because we have a very rapidly rising number of cases right now, which is both a reason to do this, but also a reason to be cautious about doing it. We have some fluctuation in case numbers inevitably because of the Christmas period. We need to see that settle a little bit over the next few days, and then we need to reach a judgment that is right in terms of weighing the risks and the benefits of this. So we would expect to do that over the next few days, with any changes coming into effect from immediately after the New Year holidays. The final point I would make, Presiding Officer, is that while the focus, because England has already done this, the focus is on reducing isolation for index cases from 10 days to 7 days, it's not the only change that we should be considering. We have a situation right now in the wake of Omicron where we ask all household contacts of positive cases to isolate for 10 days. I hope we can ease that up as well. And I think it makes sense to make sure that we are making changes in a coherent manner. So these things are not easy. I don't underestimate the reasons why there are calls for us to do this. I hope we will do this, but I don't think anybody looking, particularly at the case numbers that are being reported today, would fail to see why it is important that we take a very responsible approach to this and make sure that as far as it is possible to do with any aspect of handling this virus, we're getting it as right as we possibly can. And I'll keep Parliament updated over the next few days around the detail of any changes that we do decide on and propose.
Douglas Ross.
Businesses across Scotland are struggling with the impact of these restrictions at what should be their busiest time of the year. And many of the same businesses are also affected by these self-isolation. Absences and a lack of staff cover will mean premises having to close early or not open at all, despite staff members testing negative. I've been speaking to businesses throughout the festive period, and they're trying to plan for the next few weeks and months. But the First Minister's indecision on these self-isolation rules is continuing to cause them trouble to plan for the period ahead. What's also causing them trouble is a lack of financial support. Weeks ago, I asked the First Minister in the Chamber to get this financial package to businesses before Christmas, and she promised to do everything possible to deliver that. Given so many businesses are in dire straits and need of financial assistance now, can I ask the First Minister why they're still waiting for the money to come through?
First Minister.
Well, what Douglas Ross describes as indecision is actually responsibility. And that's the most important burden on my shoulders, is to be as responsible and as measured in taking these decisions as possible. I know that businesses are struggling, critical services are struggling with staff absences. If case numbers continue to rise, that will become more difficult, which is why we need to try to slow down the increase in cases, because it is the virus, not self-isolation, that is the cause of this problem. But the self-isolation rules need to be proportionate so that they are not exacerbating that problem. So I don't argue in any way with the central premise of the question here, but there is an element of common sense that needs to be applied as well, and that's where careful judgment comes into play. Because if we ease up on the self-isolation rules too quickly and we don't take sufficient care, then even although we're doing that for good reasons, all we will do is increase the overall numbers of infections, because we will contribute to the spread, and therefore the problem that businesses are suffering won't get better, it will actually get worse. So these are not easy judgments to arrive at. Governments elsewhere are struggling with this as well. I recognise the importance of speed, but I hope others will recognise the importance of being measured and responsible in this as well. Dealing with this virus, and I think we've all learned this over the past couple of years, every action has a reaction. Every decision you make has a potential consequence, sometimes an adverse consequence. So that calls for careful decision making, which is what we've tried to do throughout this. And as I say, we will reach a decision on this over the next few days, with any changes coming into effect after the New Year period from the 5th of January. But we're not doing nothing in the meantime. The sectoral exemption scheme is important and is already helping in many key sectors, and the changes that I've talked about today to ensure prioritisation for essential workers in access to testing will also help further. So there is no sense in which we are not taking this issue seriously, but we're simply trying to avoid compounding a problem as we try to solve that problem. Secondly, on financial support, Presiding Officer, the financial support available for businesses in Scotland right now is significantly higher proportionately than it is certainly in England. I can't speak so much for Wales and Northern Ireland. That demonstrates the seriousness with which we're taking this, and money is flowing and will flow to businesses as quickly as possible. From announcing it through to making the money available to councils, through to, I think, just days before Christmas, COSLA leaders meeting to agree that they would disperse these funds, to the checks that are being done right now to get the money out of the door. It is being done at pace, and money will start flowing to businesses in the days to come. And of course, there will be more of it as we allocate the additional funds that we have made available.
Douglas Ross.
So the First Minister has just confirmed that the money didn't get to these businesses before Christmas, and that is unfortunate because they are really struggling now. But the First Minister also mentioned access to testing. And today we've seen widespread reports of a lack of availability of testing across Scotland. And over the last few days, we've heard of results taking up to 4 days to come through. This undermines confidence in our testing system, particularly when people are having to isolate over the festive period. Now, I realise this is a UK-wide, indeed a global issue, but can I ask, what are the Scottish Government doing to ensure that people can get tested and are confident that they'll get their results quickly?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, this is a UK-wide system, and I don't say that to in any way pass responsibility. We are working closely with the UK Government to make sure that the flow of testing remains as we need it to be. There were steps taken to constrain demand in England last night, which I understand mean there are no bookings available today for physical test sites in England. While that change was being made last night, there was an administrative error made that restricted slots in the other three nations. That has now been rectified, and I went on to the system myself just about half an hour before coming to make my statement, and actually Scotland and Wales were the only parts of the UK where there was availability of PCR tests at physical sites. Now, we monitor that on an ongoing basis. There is work being done to make sure that testing capacity continues to increase, but also the prioritisation for that testing capacity is also being given due regard, and I covered some of that in my statement. There have been lengthening turnaround times. We hope they will return to normal over the course of the next couple of days. There will continue to be pressure on tests, but it is important that the system continues to flex and respond, and I've got confidence that that will be the case, and we'll continue to liaise closely with the UK Government about that. One final point to make, and I think this perhaps is a factor in some of the constrained demand constraints put on demand in England over the last few hours, is that the testing system, like other parts of the economy and critical services, will be suffering from absence rates because of COVID, which of course comes back to the earlier points about the need to take decisions, albeit careful decisions, around things like self-isolation. These are all interlinked matters, and that's why we continue to keep all of them under close review.
Call Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to offer my deepest sympathies to those that have lost a loved one, especially at this time of year. And I also want to pay tribute to Scotland's vaccinators. They continue to go above and beyond. And over the Christmas period, all our frontline workers have worked tirelessly to keep us all safe and secure. So thank you to each and every one of them, and of course their families. I can also thank all those that have come forward during the holidays to get their boosters, and to repeat a plea. If you haven't yet received your first dose or your second dose or a booster dose, please book an appointment or visit a drop-in centre today. I know what the First Minister says on isolation periods and a decision on the 5th of January, but actually staff absences are spiking now, and that's having knock-on effects on our services and indeed on industry. So can the First Minister share the scientific evidence she is relying on when asking people who have tested negative to remain in isolation for 10 days. I note, for example, there are some countries that are looking to reduce it to 5 days, that was announced just today. Every restriction has a knock-on effect for workers and businesses, particularly in hospitality and retail. So can I repeat calls for the UK Government to work with devolved governments to support workers at this time of crisis? Many are literally fighting for survival. And industries associated with hospitality, events and retail also appear to have fallen through the cracks. what action is the Scottish Government taking to ensure that all those that are eligible for support are actually receiving it? And what plans are in place now to widen support to those affected businesses, for example, the taxi trade, who have seen their income collapse but are not currently eligible for extra help?
First Minister.
Thanks for that. On the issue of staff absences, I've already recognised, and I do recognise, the burden this is placing on businesses, but also on many services across the country, which is why it's important that we do make the self-isolation rules more proportionate if we can. The science that Anna Sarwar asked me to give, it's all to do with the incubation period. We know that people can become infectious and test positive for the virus after a period of 7 days. In fact, if we cast our minds back to the earlier part of the pandemic, the isolation period, it wasn't 10 days as it is now, it used to be 14 days. So it already has been shortened, which already has introduced greater risk into this. If we're going to do that further for good reasons, we have to be aware that we increase that risk. And if we get that wrong, if we increase the risk too much, then any benefit from that will be outweighed by faster spread of the virus, which will not solve the problem for businesses. It will compound the absence problem for businesses. So I'm not disagreeing with anybody who's saying this is an important decision, but I would ask for an understanding of why it is important to get this right. It's also correct to say that different countries are coming to different conclusions here. The Centre for Disease Control in the United States, it has, as I understand it, and I may be not getting this entirely right, but reading some of this morning, as I understand it, this is for asymptomatic cases only, has reduced the isolation period to 5 days. So again, there is some difference of opinion about the appropriate degree of risk. All of that says we need to weigh these things carefully, because if we don't do that, then any benefits that we might get in the immediate term will be outweighed by the increased risks in the longer term. In terms of business support, I continue to hope that the UK government increases the level of support they're making available to business so that we are able to do likewise, although proportionately we are already delivering significantly higher business support. As I said in my statement, we have made decisions and confirmed announcements on allocation of 207 million of the 375 million that we've made available. The remainder of that we are consulting with different sectors. Can I say that will include considering support for the taxi sector? We have previously provided support for the taxi sector, but we know they are one part of the economy that suffers considerably from fewer people going out and socialising. So they are very much in our minds as we reach decisions on the allocation of the remainder of that money, and we'll set out those decisions as soon as possible.
Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, President Officer, and I welcome those comments, particularly in relation to the taxi trade, and look forward to seeing the details of that additional support. The First Minister referenced testing in her statement, and also in response to previous questions. We know that testing is the key to breaking transmission and reducing transmission as well, from lateral flow tests for visiting friends and family to the PCR tests, which determine the spread and pace of the virus. It's core to our response. And I know what the First Minister said around looking 30 minutes before she came on, but I have had constituents be in touch, and indeed people across Scotland this morning, not being able to access tests and also struggling to access lateral flow test devices too. So issues around delivery online, and even people being asked to travel to different parts of the country or having to wait as long as 72 hours to get the results. So can I ask the First Minister to consider the disruption this is having on frontline workers, the disruption it's having on services, on businesses, and literally putting livelihoods on the line? So what action has been taken to increase capacity of testing, to increase the availability of testing, and also the speed of results as we approach Hogmanay? Testing is the way to get us through this crisis.
First Minister.
Testing is one of the ways to get us through this crisis. It's a really important way, but I wouldn't want to give the impression it's the only way. Getting vaccinated is also really important, and following the advice to slow transmission is also vital at the moment. As I said in response to a previous question, as demand was constrained for England last night, an administrative error led to slots also being removed for the other three nations. That has been resolved. There will be fluctuations in availability. There will sometimes be slots available in places that are not easily accessible, which is why what I would say to people is go back and check later, because new slots are made available for PCR tests throughout the day. The work of ensuring that there is adequate supply of testing, both the sampling capacity, which is, you know, the local test sites, the mobile testing units where the tests are taken, through to the laboratory processing capacity, that all of that is fit for purpose. Because we know that for some people, getting speedy access to test results is even more important than it is for everybody, and it's important for everybody. That's why we are also within the availability, the available capacity, we're making sure there is a priority given to essential workers, those who are most clinically vulnerable, and also to those who are now eligible for some of the new treatments for COVID. So these are ongoing issues of priority work for the Scottish Government, but this is a UK system, so we require to ensure that that is done in partnership with the UK Government and the other nations. What I would say to people is there is testing capacity there, so please, if you have a positive LFD, or if you have symptoms, or if you're advised to get a test, please make sure you book it. There is also a supply of LFD tests, either from test sites or pharmacies, or by ordering online, so please make sure you make full use of that.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, 8 days ago, I asked the First Minister to set out our national capacity for PCR testing and how that would be expanded to deal with a surge in demand. As we've heard already today, we've seen numerous reports of delays across Scotland. At this time, MSPs are still in the dark about the reach of our capacity. So can I remind the First Minister of her commitment to me to update Parliament on this matter through the Scottish Parliament Information Centre? Presiding Officer, last week I met with the hospitality sector. They told me that the money on offer from the Scottish Government at the moment represents just 1/8 of their January pay bill. It will barely last them 3 days. Today's 16,000 cases will leave them in serious doubt that they'll be allowed to reopen on the 17th of January. Many businesses are on the verge of making irreversible decisions, and people are losing their jobs. So can I ask the First Minister, if her government choose to extend restrictions beyond the 17th, what reassurance can she offer that further support will be made available to a hospitality sector already on its knees?
First Minister.
Firstly, I'll make sure information on capacity and the changing nature and volume of capacity is placed in space, but I would, as I think I said when this question was posed to me before, remind people that capacity right now is not a fixed thing. There are efforts ongoing all the time to maximise capacity on a daily basis, and indeed to increase capacity. And therefore, it's important that it's not seen as something that is fixed and unchanging. We do know capacity is under pressure. I think yesterday or the day before, we reached demand took up about 85%. Of available capacity, which is getting to a level where we will start to see lengthening turnaround time. So this is ongoing work that we do to make sure that these issues are being resolved on a daily basis. On the issue of business support, we are making business support available to the maximum of our financial wherewithal. The £375 million that we have already confirmed, I would say two things. Firstly, proportionately, it is way beyond what has been made available by the UK Government for England, even although businesses there are facing the same pressures, or many of the same pressures. But secondly, I know it's not enough. I've said that all along. But we do not hold in Scotland the borrowing powers to extend financial support any further. And the way the Barnett formula works is we only get a flow of resource when the UK Government takes decisions for England, which, as is their right, they are not choosing to do at the moment. So we need to see a response from the UK Government that will allow us to increase that support further. In the meantime, we are providing support as far as we are able to do. I don't think it's helpful to speculate beyond the 17th of January at this point. I very much hope, and it is our intention, that these protections are in place only until the 17th of January, but as has been the case since day one of this pandemic, we have to keep the situation under review. What I said in my statement, I think, is worth repeating, that because, yes, we've got a rapidly rising number of cases right now, but we know that we need to judge the impact of that through monitoring very carefully the health and NHS impact I think we will have a much clearer picture over the next week or two that will then allow us to make informed judgments about how we deal with this in as proportionate a way as it's possible to do.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the December 23rd announcement by WHO that the virus can spread through short and long range aerosol or short and long range airborne transmission, could I ask the First Minister what ongoing assessment is being made regarding the implementation of FFP2 and FFP face masks frontline healthcare workers as a first-line prevention measure against acquiring COVID, which is already causing high sickness and absence among healthcare workers in Scotland? And I remind colleagues that I am part of NHS D&G's vaccination team.
First Minister.
Thank you. We have reviewed the WHO recommendations from last week and noted that the WHO has not changed its position on the route of transmission of COVID, where therefore satisfied at this stage that these areas are covered within the winter respiratory guidance that was published in November, at the end of November. That guidance provides staff with the opportunity to risk assess what level of PPE is required, so it already allows for healthcare workers to wear FFP3 masks or masks of similar standards in settings where care is provided to patients with suspected or confirmed COVID. The Health and Safety Executive is frequently consulted and supports the guidance in place, and we will continue to review all of the international evidence and advise on any required changes through the COVID nosocomial review group.
Sandesh Gulhani, to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know the dangers posed by Omicron and the balance that needs to be struck, but people struggle with the inconsistencies. Rangers fans were saying Asda was busier than Ibrox, and Celtic fans were also distraught, knowing that shopping streets and malls across the country were heaving and comparable to football stadia. My question is, does the First Minister understand the value the societal role of Scottish football plays in the mental health of hundreds of thousands of people in our communities? And will the government provide additional support to protect the mental health of fans?
First Minister.
Yes, I do understand the importance of sport, football, and indeed other spectator sport. I think the benefits of that are seen in terms of mental health and in a whole host of other ways. So nobody, including me, takes the decisions that we've had to take over the course of this pandemic lightly. I've tried to set out the rationale for limiting large-scale events. It is about the super-spreading nature of big events, given the higher transmissibility of Omicron, but also the greater impact that these events have on emergency services that are already stretched, and some of the risks associated with the travel to and from events. So it's not easy. Nobody wants to be in this position, but these are the reasons why the Scottish Government, in common with many other governments, have taken these decisions, and hopefully they will not last for very long. You know, there is always the ability to point to inconsistency. I'm never sure when questions like that are posed to me whether the argument is that we should not have restrictions in football or we should also have restrictions on shopping malls. We want to limit and minimise the protections that are in place and therefore the restrictions on people's lives. But I would ask people to remember that our core, the bedrock of the advice that we're giving right now, is to stay at home as much as you can, certainly more than would normally be the case at this time of year, to try to limit your contacts with people in other households and keep those contacts where they are happening as small as possible. So that applies regardless of the setting. There is no magic wand to wave to get ourselves out of that. The closest we've got to that is vaccination, which is why that remains so important. But while we navigate this latest wave of infection, given the greater transmissibility, all of us accepting that some of these things are just inescapable at the moment, acting in line with the guidance will get us through these things more quickly than will otherwise be the case. But I, of course, understand, and as a citizen, experience these restrictions just like others do. So none of us want these to be in place for any longer than is necessary.
Jackie Bailey, to be followed by Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We know that antiviral medication reduces the risk of people becoming severely ill with COVID. For the 180,000 people currently shielding in Scotland and for their families, this is very welcome indeed. But I understand that the eligibility criteria for getting the medication was decided by the four chief medical officers, and it doesn't cover all those currently shielding and misses out key vulnerable groups. Will the First Minister urgently review the criteria so that no one who is shielding is left out? And will she also ensure that the process is streamlined? Because having to access a PCR test and then wait for Test and Protect phone when case numbers are rising can lose valuable time. Indeed, for some, they were contacted beyond the five-day window, too late to get the medication. And I'm sure she will agree that we need to act quicker.
First Minister.
I do, which is why I'll come back to one of the points I made in my statement that I'm sure Jackie Bailey heard clearly. I'm not sure if Jackie Bailey is suggesting that I, as a politician with no clinical qualifications, should somehow substitute my judgment on eligibility for that of the four chief medical officers. I do think it is right that on issues of eligibility for antiviral treatment, particularly at this stage, that these are questions for clinicians and for our clinical advisers. Of course, we will want to see the numbers and the range of people who access antiviral treatment expand as treatments continue to expand and as our access to and the availability of these treatments continues to increase. But I do think, genuinely believe, that these are decisions that are best informed by clinical advisers, not by politicians, and I'll continue to listen carefully to what they say. The point about the speed of access to PCR tests is an important one. I know I went through a lot of information in my statement, so genuinely I know it might have been easy to pick up on this, but the prioritisation I spoke about within the PCR testing system for essential workers, I also said that we were making slots available as a priority for those clinically vulnerable and for those who are eligible for the new antiviral treatments to make sure that they are getting these test results timeously in order then to not lose out on access to treatment. So that's one of the important changes that I covered in the statement earlier.
Neil Gray to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recent weeks have made it painfully obvious that Scotland's funding arrangements are simply not fit for purpose, especially during a public health emergency. And whilst I recognise that the Scottish Government is limited in the support it can provide with the fiscal levers it has at the moment, can the First Minister expand on what more can be done to support business in the face of limited UK government action? And can she provide an update on any further discussions she's had with the Treasury on the funding they announced and whether it will need to be repaid?
First Minister.
Since the start of the pandemic, we've provided, I think, more than £4.4 billion in support to businesses up and down the country. That's been really vital help, but I recognise it doesn't go far enough to compensate every business for every loss that they have suffered. The Treasury, I think, has responded well in the pandemic to date. I think in this phase, though, we are seeing the limitations in the way in which funding decisions are taken across the UK. Whatever one's view on the Barnett formula, it's not fit for purpose in the face of a public health emergency because it depends on England deciding to take It depends on the UK government deciding to take decisions for England, which is its responsibility. But when Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland have separate responsibilities to take public health decisions, but we cannot access funding when we do so, there is clearly an asymmetric funding arrangement there that constrains our ability to take these decisions. Notwithstanding that, we have, as I've set out over the last 2 weeks, made available £375 million to support businesses. That is proportionately significantly in excess of the money made available by the Treasury. In terms of some of the decisions the Treasury has taken, not all of that, as I've covered before, is new money, and there are still some questions about whether any of it will require to be paid back. But we are acting now to maximise the support that we are able to provide to businesses and indeed acting to get that to businesses as quickly as possible.
Murdo Fraser to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister said that there were 679 people in hospital today with COVID and that the Scottish Government would be breaking down that figure between those who are in hospital because they have COVID as opposed to those who are admitted for other reasons but turn out to test positive. And I think if that figure is published, it would be very helpful in terms of telling us how serious the risk from Omicron is. But in the meantime, can I ask, in relation to the 36 people in intensive care and the 679 in hospital, do we know how many of those are vaccinated as opposed to unvaccinated? And does the First Minister think that the publication of that figure would be helpful in reinforcing the message to the public that they need to get vaccinated and take up a booster in order to best protect themselves?
First Minister.
I don't have those figures yet, but we are looking to publish much more detailed breakdowns across all of these different factors as quickly as Public Health Scotland can provide that robust breakdown for us. In previous waves of the virus, and Public Health Scotland did provide some breakdown earlier around the distinction between those in hospital because of COVID and those in hospital with COVID, but nevertheless in for some other reason. And I'm using broad figures here, and they may or may not bear out with Omicron, but in past stages, it has been roughly, very roughly, 70% in hospital. I think, and I'll correct myself later if I'm getting these figures wrong, but around 70% in hospital because of COVID, and between 20 and 30% in hospital with COVID, but not as their primary diagnosis. We do want to understand that breakdown much more with Omicron, and as we do, we will certainly look to publish those figures to aid public understanding as well. Of course, that said, somebody in hospital is somebody in hospital, and therefore is providing that pressure on the National Health Service through, of course, no fault of their own. On the issue of vaccination, again, we will look to provide more detail on that as it is available, but we do know, and I think we know this already, that vaccination with a booster jab gives all of us significantly enhanced protection against serious illness from COVID. So if you are not boosted, then you are at much more risk, not just of getting this virus, but of becoming seriously unwell and potentially dying from this virus. And therefore, I would appeal to everybody who is not yet boosted, but who is eligible to be so, to do it now, because not only is your failure to do so putting yourself at risk, you're denying the country the maximum benefit of this vaccination programme, because the more of us who are vaccinated, the less risk we are all at, and therefore the less need there will be for continued restrictions on how we live our lives. So I don't think any of us can overstate the importance of booster vaccination.
CoCab Stewart, to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Businesses understand the constraints that the Scottish Government is operating under without borrowing powers to fund additional support measures. However, as the First Minister will be aware, the restrictions have had an impact on small businesses across my constituency in Kelvin that can remain open but have experienced a significant reduction in footfall. As we look to New Year's sales, what plans does the Scottish Government have to publicise the Scotland Loves Local campaign further, and as we look onwards, what considerations are being given to bringing forward the next round of funding applications for the Scotland Loves Local Fund?
First Minister.
Well, I think it's really important to highlight the plight of small businesses, particularly those in our high streets, but also how important they are to the economy overall. We announced back in August, I think, a £10 million Scotland Loves Local multi-year programme that includes the Scotland Loves Local Fund, a national marketing campaign and a loyalty card scheme. And all of these things will be really important as we go into the new year and try to promote the benefits to our high streets of people choosing to shop locally whenever they can. Scotland Loves Local is about building the wealth of local communities, revitalising town centres. So we'll keep the effectiveness of that campaign under review, and also look to how we make sure that the funding for that flows as quickly as possible to businesses. So the phasing and the profiling of that, we will certainly keep under review over the early part of next year.
Daniel Johnson, to be followed by John Mason.
The First Minister just referenced the plight of small businesses. This is, of course, a critical time of year for retail and hospitality businesses in any circumstances, but after the last 2 years, it may well determine whether they survive at all. Given that the budget just published forecasts £2.8 billion of revenue from non-domestic rates, can I ask what assessment the Scottish Government has made in terms of the cost of lost tax revenue from business failures precipitated by the current restrictions? And also, given what the First Minister said about getting that critical money into business bank accounts as quickly as possible, what steps are being taken to ensure that that happens? And can I remind Parliament of my register of interest?
First Minister.
Councils are responsible for administering the money. I think COSLA leaders met just a few days before Christmas to agree that they would administer this tranche of funding, and therefore the work to get that money out the door is underway. In terms of some of the generic funding, where businesses that in hospitality, for example, that were funded previously, local councils will be contacting those businesses, so it's not a case of a further application. But there are still, as is always the case with public money, there will be basic checks that need to be done to make sure businesses are still in operation and are eligible for that support. But this has been done at pace, and it's important that that money gets to businesses as quickly as possible. I'll ask the Finance Secretary to write to the member with any details of current up-to-date assessments of the impact on business rates, revenue of the current restrictions and the impact they are having on businesses. But of course, we have recognised the importance of exemptions and relief around business rates over the course of the pandemic for certain sectors. We had the most generous, I think, business rates relief for retail and leisure, hospitality and aviation over the course of this financial year, and we have in the budget announced further support for part of the next financial year. So we recognise the importance of that, but we also recognise the importance of a healthy revenue stream from business rates to fund other public services. But as I say, I'll ask the Finance Secretary to write with more details of any current assessments that we're doing.
John Mason, to be followed by Julian Mackay.
Thank you very much. I wonder if the First Minister can say anything more about how business support is being sectors, because it strikes me as incredibly difficult. Even within a sector, we've heard of some taxi firms have done much better than expected, some have done worse, some restaurants are very busy, some are not, some sports events are cancelled, some are postponed. So I wonder if you could say how we're going about this.
First Minister.
I mean, this is a really important question. So much of the amounts that we have already made decisions on allocations around, that has been provided, for example, to hospitality in terms of set level grants. And as I say, hospitality businesses that previously got grants will be contacted to get this latest round of funding. But other sectors, without going into the details of which ones, have been discussing with us how the way in which financial support is provided can better be tailored to reflect actual losses by different businesses. And I referenced some of the issues there in the sports sector, which has been badly affected right now. But some of that will be recouped as events are rescheduled. That won't be possible for everything. So this is a mixture of sort of one-size-fits-all grants and much more targeted support, taking account of the variable degree of impact within different sectors. And on that latter one, it's important that we consult properly, which is why some of the funding we've made available, we're still consulting how best to allocate and distribute that. But in general terms, we've already confirmed just over £200 million that will go to hospitality businesses, the wedding sector, supply chain businesses, wholesalers affected by hospitality cancellations, parts of tourism, public transport providers and the culture and events sector. Decisions on the allocation of the remaining funds may be more targeted, but will also enable, as I hope, to reach sectors, and I've already referenced the taxi sector, that are not already covered by the support already announced.
Julian Mackay, to be followed by Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. CO2 monitors are being shared by multiple classes in some schools. With case numbers still rising and the return from school holidays just over a week away, could the First Minister set out what measures are being considered to ensure that the return to school is safe for pupils and staff and minimises any disruption to learning, and whether she has received any update from the GCVI following the approval of the Pfizer vaccine by the MHRA for 5 to 11-year-olds?
First Minister.
In response to the first part of the question, obviously we previously made funding available to local authorities for the acquisition of CO2 monitors and looked to local authorities to make sure that they are doing proper assessments of ventilation and making any changes required. Ventilation is a key part of how we ensure that schools are kept as safe as possible. Updated guidance was issued around safety in schools and other education settings just before the end of term to give local authorities and schools clarity on the steps that they are required to take in advance of the new term. Let me repeat, it remains our priority to keep schools open to minimise further disruption on children's education, but it is vital that we, in doing so, we make sure schools are kept as safe as possible. In terms of the JCVI point, obviously some recommendations have already been made around vulnerable young people and access to vaccines. Obviously, there are issues around making sure that we have adequate supplies of vaccine, and there are adequate supplies of vaccine for the programme at the moment. I hope that we will be in a position in the not too distant future where we can start to offer vaccination or at least offer the possibility of vaccination to 5 to 12-year-olds. But obviously we continue to be informed by the recommendations of the JCVI in that regard.
Thank you. Before I bring in Jenny Minto, I fully appreciate the First Minister's desire to provide comprehensive responses, but we have many members who would like to put a question and I'd be grateful if we could pick up the pace. So I call Jenny Minto to be followed by Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what plans are in place to mitigate the effects of current increased transmission of COVID on Lifeline ferry services.
First Minister.
Thanks. And Presiding Officer, I will try to be briefer in my answers, but let me repeat my offer rather than stinting on the answers I give people to stay here for as long as is required to answer all of the questions that members have for me. That, of course, is a matter for you. In terms of Lifeline ferry routes, obviously a matter of critical importance, and we are seeing an impact on ferry services as we are across our other transport providers. CalMAC is engaging with the Maritime and Coast Guard Agency around allowing passengers to remain in vehicles, for example, when certain restrictions are imposed. But there are also other steps being taken to try to ensure that as cases rise, we are minimising the impact on these services. And I'll ask the Transport Minister to keep the member and indeed all members with an interest, particularly in ferry services, up to date over the next few weeks.
Thank you, and thank the First Minister for her comment there. And I think that being the case, and given the level of interest, I'd suggest that in the first instance we continue to around 3:30. We'll see how we're progressing. I call Megan Gallagher to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mental health nursed beyond throughout the pandemic. However, many across all psychiatric services have found themselves in dangerous situations as they've had to restrain patients without the support of a psychiatric doctor, security team or police presence. This is due to the strain on our NHS during the COVID-19 pandemic. First Minister, many of these nurses are newly graduated university students. What additional measures can the Scottish Government put in place to help protect mental health nurses on the front line?
First Minister.
I think that's a really important point. Mental health nurses in all parts of the NHS do a vital job, but those who are most on the front line dealing with particularly vulnerable patients not only do a vital job, they often do that job at some risk to themselves. So the support services they have are vital. I will ask the Health Secretary to write to the member with further details of the support services in place, but also what further action we can take to ensure that, notwithstanding the pressures that are being faced, people working in these positions do not feel themselves even more exposed than might otherwise be the case.
Pauline McNeill to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, as you know, the hospitality sector are absolutely terrified of the impact of recent substantial restrictions, but especially smaller venues who can't easily apply the 1 metre distancing. Can I ask the First Minister, given that you said earlier that the support could be tailored to those who need it most, should there be a rapid business response team set up to ensure that the £42 million that you announced today is targeted where it's really needed to ensure survival of those businesses?
First Minister.
Well, I think we need to get the balance right, and we're seeking to do that between a level of funding support that it will be available to all businesses. It's never going to be enough to fully compensate them, but the grant approach with standard levels of grant is an important way of doing that. But over and above that, that we look at businesses across whole sectors or within sectors who are being disproportionately impacted. So as well as additional funding for the hospitality sector, today I announced a further £10 million for businesses within that sector who are most impacted by the return to table service, and indeed many of them will be the ones that are most impacted by the return to some form of physical distancing as well. So that will allow that slightly more targeted approach to augment the general baseline level of grant support that is available. So yes, we will seek to be as generous as we can be, but also as targeted as we need to be. And obviously the discussions we have with individual sectors will allow us to tailor that response appropriately.
Rona Mackay, to be followed by Alexandra Burnett.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Tragically, high-profile court cases in the media recently have emphasised the risks of domestic abuse to children. Would the First Minister join me in using her social media platform this afternoon to highlight services where children or adults worried about children at this time can turn to if they're concerned for their safety?
First Minister.
Well, I'd like to thank Rona Mackay for raising this issue. I mean, clearly the conditions that we're all living under right now do further increase the risk to children, to young people, to those who are vulnerable to domestic abuse. And children and young people, of course, have the right to be protected from all forms of harm and abuse, and domestic abuse always has an impact on any children. Let me just share some information for anybody listening who needs help. If you are a child or a young person and you're worried about anything or you're looking for some advice right now, then you can phone Childline. You can phone that on 0800 1111. 0800 1111. So if you're a child or a young person, please don't hesitate to call Childline for any help or advice that you think you need. If anyone else is worried that a child they know might be in immediate danger, my advice would be to contact the police on 999. If you're worried about a child not in immediate danger, you should share your concerns with your local authority social work department. These agencies will then assess the risk and take appropriate action to protect the child. And I will indeed share Childline contact details on social media later today once this session of Parliament has concluded.
I call Alexandra Burnett to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over the past few days, there have been worrying reports of a significant increase in the time for individuals to receive their PCR results, in some cases as long as 4 days. People are being forced to isolate from family and close friends over Christmas and Boxing Day because they're awaiting test results. Now, given both Christmas and the rise in demand for tests due to Omicron were entirely predictable, how is this allowed to happen? And what urgent action is the Scottish Government doing to both address this and ensure it doesn't happen again?
First Minister.
This is a UK Government wide system. It is administered by the UK Government. We work closely with the UK Government to make sure capacity is sufficient and that any issues are resolved as quickly as possible, and we take joint responsibility for that. We did see lengthening turnaround times over the last few days. That will happen when demand is high, and of course high demand is being compounded by high staff absences, even in our testing system right now. I hope these turnaround times are shortening again and will continue to be shorter over the next period. And as I said earlier on, we've also built in some prioritisation within the system to make sure, while everybody needs test results as quickly as possible, those who most need them quickly get that priority. So the work with the UK Government to ensure a speedy and effective turnaround of the testing system is work that is ongoing on a daily basis.
Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what steps the Scottish Government has taken to assist those suffering from long COVID to return to work, particularly our frontline health professionals.
First Minister.
The NHS already has policies in place which help to facilitate a return to work and encourage attendance for employees where health issues impact on their ability to be at work. Employees can be facilitated in a return to work by discussion with their manager and occupational health, and occupational health can support managers and workers with a safe return to work. There are a number of options available that support employees back into the workplace, flexible working, for example, phased returns or a change to duties or working pattern. COVID sick pay policies continue to apply, including for those with long COVID. So anybody in that position, health professionals or others, I would encourage and advise a discussion with your employer, and if you have occupational health services at your place of work, with them to discuss how best you can return to work in a way that suits your health circumstances.
Martin Whitfield, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister has talked about decisions being reached around the 12th of January, and indeed the isolation period for index cases potentially being announced as early as the 5th of January. And I know the First Minister will not have underestimated the effect of this new virus type on pupils and our young people returning to school, and particularly those who are returning in January to their preliminary exams. But can she say what discussion has been had over the 21-22 exam diet, and what new advice has been given to schools regarding the evidence from those pupils who will need to isolate?
First Minister.
There's no change at present to the arrangements that were set out by the Education Secretary not too long before the Christmas recess. I can't recall exactly when she set that out, but the expectation of exams going ahead this coming academic year, but also the contingency arrangements in place and the considerations that would inform any of that. And I'm happy to, well, MD can go and look at the detail of that, but I'm happy to ask the Education Secretary to write to the member with a reminder and an update on those plans.
Well, Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The range of COVID challenges experienced by many of my constituents has highlighted the critical role played by Scotland in leading and delivering world-class COVID-19 research, particularly as we respond to variants such as Omicron. What assurance can the First Minister provide that everything will be done to support continued funding opportunities for research activity, both in the short and the long term?
First Minister.
We continue to work through both the Chief Scientist Office and NHS Research Scotland to invest in research infrastructure that will support health boards in hosting and participating in a very wide range of clinical research. That obviously includes research relating to all clinical areas and in particular to studies associated with COVID, helping to understand COVID, trials of COVID treatments and vaccine, and support for research in specific clinical areas is provided by clinical research networks and specialty groups. So I recognise the importance of continued support for this, and actually we take the opportunity to pay tribute to everybody across our research community whose work over the past couple of years has helped us get to where we are now with a much greater, not a full understanding of COVID, but a much greater understanding, and of course with the advances we've seen around vaccines and treatment for COVID as well.
Sharon Dowie, to be followed by Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While our pubs, nightclubs and hotels require support because of the direct effects of the government's restrictions, many other businesses, such as those in the supply chain and taxi drivers, are also losing income at what should be their busiest time of the year. I've also been contacted by local small businesses who feel they have been put into an unofficial lockdown as people do what is being asked by the government and stay at home. Can the First Minister reassure me that all businesses who have been affected by restrictions will be able to access government grant funding?
First Minister.
I've already covered this on a number of occasions already today, so I will very briefly recap. Obviously, the level of funding available in Scotland is proportionately much greater than is the case elsewhere in the UK, because we have prioritised support for businesses. Of the £375 million, just over £200 million of that has already been allocated. That covers hospitality, leisure, events, and some of the supply chain businesses affected by the advice we've given and also some of the other protections that are in place. The remainder of that funding, we are in consultation with different sectors. I've said already that will include the taxi industry, for example, to make sure that those parts of the economy, even if they're not directly affected by some of the protections in place, nevertheless have an indirect effect. We cannot compensate every business, I've said that already, without further significant funding being made available by the Treasury, which is why I hope all members, including the member here, will join with us and calling on the Chancellor to make that additional funding available so that we can go even further than we are going from within the Scottish Government's own resources.
Maureen McNair, to be followed by Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Omicron variant has meant that some public health measures have had to be reintroduced to protect the public and our National Health Service. These measures are asking that social contact is limited. The First Minister will be concerned about the impact these measures could have on social isolation. What efforts are the Scottish Government making to give advice and support to people who may be impacted most by social isolation?
First Minister.
There's no doubt that the advice we're given right now does have an impact on isolation and loneliness and will be exacerbating that for many people. And it's one of the reasons why I hope we don't have to give this advice for very long. But the more we all stick to it now, the quicker we will get through this. There's a range of support that is available. I think I would highlight now the National Assistance Helpline, which is available Monday to Friday, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. That can assist with practical support that people need while self-isolating, for example, but it can also link individuals to local support services to help reduce social isolation. So the number for that is 0800 111 4000, 0800 111 4000. We've also committed to additional investment to tackle social isolation and loneliness and already made an additional £1 million available to support the work of organisations involved in this area. And lastly, support is available through a range of different organisations. I would highlight Breathing Space, Clear Your Head, the Scottish Association for Mental Health, and Samaritans, of course, have a 24-hour phone line as well. This is a tough time for everybody, particularly I recognise for those living alone and already isolated, but support is out there if you need it, and please make sure you use it.
Liam Kerr, to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Omicron study suggests that there's a two-thirds reduction in the risk of COVID-19 hospitalisation for those with Omicron, although, of course, it looks as though there'll be a far greater number of cases. How have the conclusions of this study informed and shaped the government's COVID strategy, First Minister?
First Minister.
The study is really encouraging, and just like everybody else, I want it to be borne out with further data. So it's already informing how we're going to go about assessing judgments over the next phase, and I went into that in quite some detail in my statement about looking much more at the impact, not just at the overall case numbers, but at the impact of those cases, particularly on individual health of people infected, but also the overall health impact of the wave on the NHS. I really, really want to believe that the early data, what the early data is telling us, turns out to be the case, and there's no reason at this stage to believe it won't be. But when you have the authors of these studies themselves saying that it is early data, that it needs more data to be sure, and that the transmissibility, the much higher transmissibility of Omicron could outweigh the benefits of a lower risk of hospitalisation, so therefore we still need to be cautious in the immediate terms, then I think that also needs to continue to inform our approach. We all want this to be over as quickly as possible, but as I've said in relation to the fine judgments around self-isolation, if we take precipitate action that then feeds greater spread of the virus, we actually set ourselves back rather than propel ourselves forward. So difficult though it is for everybody, we've got to make sure we get these judgments as right as we possibly can.
Rhoda Grant, to be followed by Willie Rennie.
It's concerning that the First Minister has said that hospitality support will be allocated on the same basis as before. businesses that don't pay business rates, such as floating hotels and restaurants, lost out previously, and also kennels and carteries that were categorised as storage and distribution businesses that depend on tourism to have been allocated and categorised as such. Can I ask the First Minister if she'll ensure those businesses will receive equal assistance this time?
First Minister.
I recognise the issues that have been raised here. There is always a tension between having as standardised a system as possible to get the money out the door as quickly as possible. The more targeted and bespoke these schemes become, the longer it takes to establish and check eligibility and actually get the money to businesses, which is why for hospitality, we have, at least for the initial funding, operated on the basis of the same approach to grant funding as previously. But as I've said a few times already today, with the portion of the funding that we've not yet taken decisions around, we do want to look at more targeted support for sectors that haven't previously been supported or who don't get the more generic support. So I can't give an absolute guarantee that every form of business that Rhoda Grant has mentioned there will be covered, but I will give a guarantee that we will look to reach as many businesses as possible and, with this next tranche of funding, try to target that as carefully as we possibly can.
Willie Rennie, to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
This week it has been suggested that care home visiting should be stopped. I support safe visits of the mental well-being of residents. It's common sense, but what does the First Minister have to say to anxious families, and can she guarantee them that safe visiting will continue?
First Minister.
My apologies to Willie Rennie. His line broke up a little bit in the middle of that question. I think I got the gist of it, but if I appear to be answering a question he didn't ask me, that is the reason. I think he asked me about comments at the weekend, which I think came from the Chief Executive of Scottish Care, about the need to perhaps stop care home visiting. And if I'm misquoting anybody, I apologise for that. I do not want to see us go back to a position where we don't have visiting in care homes. The safety of residents in care homes is obviously, for reasons we all understand, vitally important, but we want to continue to support safe visiting. As we faced Omicron, we have issued guidance about what safe visiting means in terms of numbers and such like, but for the mental health of residents in care homes, and indeed for the mental health and wellbeing of their families and loved ones, it's really important that we continue to support safe visiting, and I can give an assurance that that is a priority for us.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister has told us she doesn't know how many people are in hospital because of COVID, how many people are in intensive care because of COVID, and of those, how many are unvaccinated? Well, Public Health Scotland should have those figures, and if they don't, then questions need to be asked. Can the First Minister ensure that those figures are published today and that they're published every single week from now on in?
First Minister.
No, I won't, because we need to publish figures when they're robust. Public Health Scotland is working to break down these figures as much as possible. I think we publish data and data at a level of granularity that is probably, amongst the best anywhere, but we always want to understand that carefully. But it takes work and effort, and it takes a lot of expertise to do that in a way that is robust and therefore reliable. And I absolutely refute the suggestion that somehow Public Health Scotland has been dragging its feet on that. Public Health Scotland is an organisation full of people that are working literally round the clock to help with this response to COVID. The wealth of information it already publishes has helped inform our response, and as this data becomes more robust, it will do so too. But let me thank everybody in Public Health Scotland for the work that they do literally as we speak.
And Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think many people will be deeply concerned by the answer that the First Minister just gave to my colleague Graeme Simpson. She's not been very clear about the statistics, and this is something that the public deserve to know very clearly about. What the First Minister has been clear about is that the government have put in place restrictions and guidance to slow transmission while we increase vaccination. And given that the First Minister has said that we remain on track to meet our vaccination target by the end of this year, when will the government set out its conditions for reducing restrictions in the new year?
First Minister.
As has been the case, we'll take account of transmission rates, we'll take account of vaccination and the overall health impact. I think anybody who listened to my statement will see that one of the key conditions there is being as assured as we can be that the volume of cases is not going to overwhelm the economy, the NHS and cause serious health harm. I wish possibly more than anybody in this parliament that these decisions were really straightforward and binary and that there was a manual that told you exactly what to do. That's not the case for any government anywhere. It involves good advice, good clinical expertise, which the Scottish Government is very blessed and lucky to have, and it involves careful judgment that on some occasions I accept we won't always get absolutely right, but we try our best to get that as right as possible. And I come back to, you know, the public should not be disappointed in the answer I gave to the previous question. The public should be assured about that so that the public knows when it is reading data published by Public Health Scotland, it can have a confidence in the robustness of that data. I was just reading before I came into the chamber here, the Prime Minister saying this morning that the majority of people in ICU in England were unvaccinated, and then a clarification had to be issued saying that that was just anecdotal evidence. I don't think we want to be in a position where we're making decisions on the basis of anecdotal evidence. We want this information to be robust, and we're very lucky in Scotland to have the expertise and the skills of Public Health Scotland in getting us into that position.
Thank you. That concludes the statement by the First Minister on COVID-19 update, and I close this meeting.